The following program contains adult language and offensive material. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good evening and welcome to the monumental edition of Campus Crossfire, Moses versus Abel, a debate of biblical proportions. Right here to my left, I have the infamous Gary Moses Bowen.
Glad to be here.
Yes, we will be taking your calls a little bit later. The phone number, 575-6930. But first, we're going to take a little calls from him. Later, we're going to talk to his opponent, Abel. We're going to have a great time. Don't go anywhere. This is Moses versus Abel, a debate of biblical proportions.
Call me.
Welcome back. We'll open the phones after we talk to Moses for a minute and ask him a few questions. Moses, how did you exactly get this name? And tell us a few things about yourself.
Hey, I am a lover of God, love the Bible, and today I issued a challenge for anybody to try to figure out where my nicknames came from. At OU, it's Preacher Gary. OSU, it's Preacher Bob. And at U of A, it's Moses. If you can figure out where those nicknames came from, you get a prize. And I just love the Lord, I love the Bible, I love Christianity, and I like being on this show.
So, you know the reasons why we had this this big debate here, this event here on Campus Crossfire. We were looking to exploit the opportunity that you have been
that
pretty
That is a cool
popular,
tie. I want you to know
popular.
That tie is cool.
I appreciate it. We have you're a pretty prominent figure here at the university, and you know, when your opponent today was arrested after speaking with you, or speaking in your place, there were some things that went on, such as you wonder if his free speech was encroached upon. Would you say that he was that happened to him, or what would you say about Abel here?
First of all, I'd like to say that the police officers at the University of Arkansas are excellent. They're some of the best I've ever known, and Special Officer Dobb. And Officer Ramirez and others, you know who you are, just excellent at their job. So I feel like, hey, God is sovereign, he's in control, and things are going like they're supposed to.
There's a rumor out there that you just come to this campus to inflame people and possibly provoke violence to where you can sue someone. Is that true?
Well, actually, if it was true, then I would have had a good opportunity when Abel Tomlinson was in my face with using rhetoric and seemed potentially violent. So if I wanted that, why would I call for police assistance to help monitor? It doesn't make sense, does it?
Well, you know, we'll have the viewer audience tell us that about that a little later, because we're going to have a clip. But is your wife a lawyer? Does she sue people on your behalf?
Man, I wish she was. If she was and I could get her to, I could hire her to sue people on my behalf, I would do that, because lawsuits are a good thing, come from the book of Judges right out of the Bible.
What would you say your denomination is?
Well, I'm non-denominational, but I like to call myself a Messianic Jew. I believe in the whole Bible, the Torah, the whole scriptures, and I believe Jesus was a Jew, and all Christians ought to love the Jewish faith.
You talk about in a lot of your speeches on campus, you condemn what seems like a lot of people to hell. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Well, I think it's so funny, because I show up at a college university, and I open the Bible and start preaching, and people will say something like, you're condemning everybody to hell, but I don't have the power to condemn anybody. It's not like I'm some Martian from outer space can come down and condemn people. I'm just telling people what the Bible says, that if they don't believe in Jesus, they're condemned already. I didn't do it. The Bible says they're condemned already, because without Christ, there's condemnation.
So you have a very strict view of the Bible.
I think I got a rational view of the Bible. So I maybe strict view seems kind of the wrong way to word it. I believe the Bible. The Bible says it. I believe it. End of story. Somebody said that they don't believe that Jonah was swallowed by a whale. Well, if the Bible would have said that Jonah swallowed the well, I would have believed that. But it doesn't say that. But I don't have any problem believing the fundamental truths of Scripture. I think they're all right.
Would you call yourself a fundamentalist?
I believe in putting the fun back in fundamentalism. I am a fundamentalist big time.
And can you maybe tell our audience what that means? You feel fundamentalist?
Yes, basically, we still believe the Bible. Unlike some of the ministers at the University of Arkansas who are signing these forms to promote sinful leaders of their group, in the name of affirmative action, we still believe the Bible, the whole Bible, and that sin is wrong, and it's wrong to lie.
Speaking of affirmative action, do you you have a special song on that we had a chance to see on YouTube, if you happen to catch that?
No kidding. They put that on YouTube.
Yeah, they did. It was on there. But if we had some people wanting to call in, we've got some callers getting ready to have on here. The number is 757-6930. Also, if you'd rather email your question in, it is uacrossfire@yahoo.com. Excuse me, that's 575-6930. So, the songs, you sing a lot of songs that are a little controversial. Tell us about those.
Well, I like to sing, and when I was preaching on campus, different campuses, different times, it seemed like songs just began to spark out of me, and thoughts that come along about the sins of our day, and I just sing about them, because I believe that the songs sometimes tell a story like preaching doesn't, and so I preach in the songs.
What is the cheerleader song that you sing?
Well, that's one of my favorite songs. It just talks about first the book of Timothy mentions that women should dress modestly, and cheerleaders, you know, just flat aren't dressed modestly. So I sing about what that means, and it's a fun song.
Well, we have our first caller here. Michael, what do you have to say for us?
I'm sorry. Hello?
Hi, Michael. Go ahead.
Hello?
Go ahead, Michael.
Hi, I had a question for Moses. I was wondering why he thought women wearing jeans are sluts.
Moses, your response?
Well, that's just hard to answer. It's kind of like, why did you stop beating your wife? I have never said women wearing jeans are sluts. It's a word I'm not even comfortable saying. So I just can't answer a question that I didn't say. Oh, by the way, it is a very common thing for people to hear somebody say that I said, which is against the Ten Commandments to bear false witness against your neighbor. If I didn't say it, I say enough controversial stuff without having to defend stuff I didn't say. So say something I really said, and then I'll go along that line.
What would you go on and say about the rhetoric that goes around on campus? So you've got people, surely there's not everyone going around on campus lying about what has been said.
Surely not.
What are some of the more controversial things that you say?
Well, controversial things I say is that the Bible's right, there's no errors in it, and that Jesus Christ is the only way to the kingdom of heaven, and, you know, if you don't live for God, you're going to go to hell. I mean, the things I say are just the fundamental truths of Scripture. You know, the Bible teaches that men should have short hair, women should have long hair. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Things that are just in the Bible. It's just kind of interesting how people, it's like they're mad at me for saying it when it's just in the Bible.
We've got another caller, David.
Yeah, hey. I've got a question for Moses.
Go on.
A lot of kids around campus have been throwing around slang terms about perpetual drug usage by yourself. Is that true?
Perpetual what?
Drug use?
Drug use by who?
By you, Moses.
Oh, yeah, I used to smoke dope and have long hair and get drunk, and that's why I lost some of my brain cells right there. But Jesus saved me. He forgave me. I got a haircut, started preaching the gospel, quit taking drugs, been drug-free for a long time. I take no drugs.
Tell us about that. At what point in time in your life did you change yourself around as you said?
I'd love to. There was a fellow one time looked me in the eye, and he said, Gary Don, you are stupid. When he said, you are stupid, it was one of the kindest things he ever said to me when we were thinking about smoking some dope and distributing some dope as I used to give out drugs. And he said, you are stupid. And when he told the truth about how stupid I was, I stopped and thought about it, and it's just stupid to take drugs. You know, that's just dumb. And so controversial things woke me up, and little by little I heard people confront my stupidity and tell me how wrong I was, and it makes you think. So I changed when I heard the truth, a real strong truth. And that's kind of why I use a very direct approach in calling people stupid. So, you know, it's just a way to wake you up. Don't be a dope.
We've got caller Grant on the line. Grant?
Yes.
Go right ahead.
Hey, I had a question asked to Moses. You know, it says in the Bible that you're not supposed to pass judgment, and I'm just wondering, when I've seen him preach, he always calls us folks in fraternities and sororities sluts and people that are going to hell, and Moses, what gives you the right to say things like that?
Well, I wished I was being accused of something I actually say. The word slut is not a word I'm comfortable with. But the idea of just judging is, when he told me I was stupid for smoking dope, he was judging me. When my friend said, you're stupid, that judgment helped me. And so I think it's just a misunderstanding. I mean, the Bible has a whole book of judges. Jesus said to judge righteous judgment. And the hypocrites are forbidden to judge. I mean, that's clear. Judge not, lest you be judged. But that's not addressed to the righteous folk. I mean, preachers have to judge. I mean, a judgment is a decision. You have to make a judgment. I don't judge people's motive. I just judge their actions. I mean, if I know your actions are stupid, then that's a stupid thing to do. And I think that's the kind of key there. You know, you got to love people. And Jesus is the ultimate judge. And if Jesus is going to judge us in the end, you know, I say we just need to put forth the judgment that the Bible says. So, you know, just don't believe everything you hear about what people say and quit judging me. That's pretty good.
We'll take another caller. Thomas, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm wondering, Moses, do you think the Bible should be taken literally, word for word?
Yeah, I think literature should always be taken literally, word for word. But what you got to do when you take literature literally, you know, there's a literary operation going on when you read a thing. To take something literally is to take it for what it was meant to say. And so, of course, everything the Bible means to say, you should take it for what it's meant to say. Nothing more, nothing less. Just interpret the Scripture from a right point of view, which is a rational, reasonable point of view. God is a God of reason. If it's not reasonable, it's not truth.
Before we go, can you possibly explain the glass that you brought here with you?
Yeah, I've got the cup of wrath, and we oftentimes teach on this. This is probably the biggest, most controversial thing I talk about on the campuses, is that God actually in the Bible says some things that are very judgmental, very vengeful. The actions God has taken, such as the flood and Sodom and Gomorrah and other things, are very vengeful upon humanity. So when we're dealing with this issue, I try to teach, let people understand that the evidence, one of the greatest evidences of the existence of God, is that God is angry with the wicked, and it's shown by the judgments he's pouring out upon the earth. So people sometimes become victims, it seems, when actually they're literally criminals being punished by a God that actually hates sin.
Well, it's very interesting to have you. We'll be, of course, bringing you back on the set. Right now we're going to go to break and bring on Abel, the controversial opponent tonight on this debate.
Enjoyed being here.
When the names of the first graduating class of 1876 were drawn in concrete, the University of Arkansas's senior walk became a benchmark for all future students. The tradition now winds 3 miles across a campus that proudly embraces its past and a future endowed by a $1 billion fundraising campaign. The names include world leaders, scientists, teachers, and famous Razorbacks. The University of Arkansas, where every graduate is carved into history.
Welcome back to Campus Crossfire's legendary edition of Moses versus Abel, the debate, of course, of biblical proportion. We've got here with us Abel, and before we start with Abel, I want to plug our email address, uacrossfire@yahoo.com, if you'd like to email in a question instead of call. If you'd like to call, the number is 575-6930. Now, Abel, tell us a little about yourself. You know, Moses is pretty famous on campus. Mm-hmm. We see him all the time. We don't get to see you as much.
Yeah, I'm just a student here at the university, a graduate student. I graduated summa cum laude, so I'm a good student. And I'm kind of a pantheist, so I believe that everything is God and God is everything. And this is totally in agreement with physics and evolutionary biology, as opposed to fundamentalist Christianity, which is anti-science, anti-intellectualism.
So you've got, of course, rationally different point of view from Mr. Moses.
Yeah, I'd like to say something about that. And I, really fundamentalist Christianity, I feel, is opposed to rationality, rational thinking and reason, which is the foundation of science. And so I hope everybody watching this doesn't expect me to convince Moses with ration and reason, because fundamentalist Christianity relies on blind faith, which has nothing to do with rationality and reason.
Now let's get back to that day last semester when you were arrested for showcasing what you believe to be free speech.
The situation happened is Moses is preaching his usual hellfire and brimstone, telling everybody they're going to hell if you have long hair man or short hair woman, you wear pants, or all these ridiculous petty things. I don't feel God is petty and cares about ridiculous little things. He cares about huge immorality. I don't mean to say he. But I tried to debate Moses and point out the hypocrisy of pro-life. He was supporting Republicans. It was election day. He was saying, vote for Republicans, support Bush. So that's the problem I have, is their support of the Republican Party and Bush. I feel both parties are corrupt, but the Republicans particularly with Bush. And it really made me mad. It was election day. I didn't know the Democrats were going to win. I was scared. And so I was, I tried to debate him. He kept interrupting me. I went and grabbed my megaphone and read a speech I'd written for an anti-war rally.
Yeah, and so in this speech that you gave, what ultimately were you trying to get across? Were you trying to reach Moses at that point in time, or were you trying to reach the students?
Reach the students. You know, most students think he's funny and laugh at him, or they ignore him. Most students say, ignore him and he'll go away. And I don't think either of those are appropriate reactions. I don't think he's funny, and I don't think you should ignore him, because I feel that fundamentalist Christianity and fundamentalist Muslims are one of the greatest threats to the planet and human existence and to America.
What did you think would happen after you brought the megaphone out
You know, and the thing is having a megaphone without a permit is an infraction, like a parking ticket. I should have got a $100 fine. Mm-hmm. I had my freedom of speech violated. I should not have been arrested and put in a cold concrete cell without any thing to keep me warm for 13 hours with a violent meth addict. I was there for 13 hours, and I felt that was very unjust.
So, do you believe the campus police was it?
Yes, I have no problem with Moses. The campus police was wrong for arresting me.
Okay. And we have an email right now. Looks like that's being used. We have it up on the screen. It asks you, you were quoted in The Traveler saying that Jesus essentially is a communist hippie. What rationale and or what justification have you to make such claims?
Well, Jesus preached a message of peace and love, which is what a lot of hippies say. There's two groups of hippies. There's the lazy ones that don't do anything, that are dirty, and then there's some that are really active and try to do good things for the environment and for our government and the educational community. And so he supported peace and love like the hippies, and also, as far as a communist goes, he said that wealthy men can't enter heaven, give all your money and wealth away, because you're going to have a really hard time getting to heaven being wealthy, which is an important point, because the Bush administration is the richest administration ever.
So when you look at the Bible, Moses obviously has what he says a literal translation. Mm-hmm. What translation do you use?
I feel the Bible has been used to justify a lot of the most violent atrocities in human history. That's what made me disgusted by Christianity when I was younger. I'm an ex-atheist. And I don't think anyone should translate it literally, because the Bible shows a picture of God, a violent, mean, vindictive jerk. I mean, he murders hundreds of thousands of people, supports the murdering of almost over 2 million people. So it's contradictory to "Thou shalt not kill."
We have a caller right now. Preston, go ahead.
Yes, Abel?
Yeah.
Don't you feel, well, first of all, how was your prison time?
It wasn't fun. It was cold, and they were really lazy in the jail, and it took them 13 hours to book me. I didn't get out till 3 o'clock. There was a violent meth addict in there with bleeding sores all over his body, and I was locked in there with a little slit in the door. And it was really scary. He kept talking about wanting to kill everybody. And it's partially Moses' fault I got in there. He called the cops. And I'm mostly mad at the officer who arrested me unjustly, though.
Okay. Well, we appreciate you coming on here, of course. Is there anything that, you look at this stack of books that you brought here with you. What is that supposed to mean?
I think we should use multiple resources in finding our spirituality and our religion, not just one, because you should compare and contrast. And really some of these other texts, Kingdom of God is Within, the Upanishads, the Bhagavad Gita, offer a similar message as Jesus about love and being nice to everyone, but they're much more less unadulterated. There's not so much violence and horrible. There's rape and supportive slavery and incest in the Bible. It's really disgusting and scary.
We have a caller, Grant.
Yes, hey, I got a question for Amber.
Yeah.
I would like to know more about your cellmate's cold sores on his knuckles.
Oh, that's not a big deal. I mean, he was bleeding.
So what we've got here is we've got the Bhagavad Gita. That's not exactly what we would call a Christian work there. What does it offer for you?
I think all the religions are speaking about truth, and it's just a matter of proportion. I would say the Bhagavad Gita has got 90% truth, the Bible maybe 10%. They all have bits of truth, and I think it's best if people compare and contrast and take away what seems rational and reasonable and throw away the garbage.
So would you say you read the Bible regularly, or do you consult these other resources?
No, I've read most of the Bible, and it's pretty scary. I wouldn't recommend it to any children. There's rape, incest, and murder in there, mass scale. It's a really scary book. I would never let my daughter read it, especially the Old Testament. Jesus has a lot cleaner message. The New Testament's a little better.
So you would you almost say disregard the Old Testament?
I would say that if you read it literally, you're a scary dude. And I mean, the Bible tells you to kill witches, kill homos, kill fortune tellers, kill your kids if they hit you, kill your kids if they talk bad. It says to smash babies' heads against the rock. It says kill adulterers, fornicators, anyone who follows other religions, non-believers, false prophets, kill women who are not virgins when married, kill blasphemers, and on and on. And so really, if you're going to interpret the Bible literally, you should support killing homosexuals.
We have a caller here. Benoit, would you like to ask a question?
Yes.
Go right ahead.
My question is, what are you doing?
What am I doing? I'm a graduate student here.
What? Okay. So what are you doing here, I guess, in this sense that, what are you doing on this show? What would you like to get across, maybe to the campus?
I feel that this is an emergency in America, and a lot of students are apathetic, and they don't see the danger that fundamentalist Christianity and fundamentalist Muslims pose to America and the world. I rank it up there with the threat of nuclear holocaust and global warming. It's really a danger, and fundamentalist Christians are just as dangerous as Muslims because they support the Republican Party, which has made an illegal and immoral war. They support torture. They're really dangerous, and we're the most powerful military. If we have these fundamentalists supporting these politicians with nuclear weapons, it's really scary. They could start holy war with the Muslims, and we'll have a nuclear holocaust.
John, would you like to ask Abel a question?
Yeah, I would. I think he's a fucking lunatic.
I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, you may not cuss on this show. That is not allowed. We'd appreciate the...
But, I don't mind. I don't feel that I'm any more crazy than these people that take the Bible literally. I don't know,
Well, so what would you say the number one complaint or disagreement that you have about Mr. Bowman's actions on campus?
I think he should have the freedom of speech to say whatever he wants. I don't think he should condemn everyone to hell or say everyone is going to hell according to the Bible. But the problem I have is his support of the Republicans. He was telling people to vote Republican on Election Day. And 17 million, he lied. He said he was a Messianic Jew, but previously he said he's a Pentecostal. And then he said he is a Southern Baptist today, earlier. And Southern Baptists vote in a perfect block for the Republican Party on two divisive, superficial issues when there's many other issues. And I think that it's a great danger.
We have our last caller of the evening. Adam, go ahead. Adam, are you there?
Hello?
Okay, Adam, go ahead.
Hello?
All right, Adam. I guess we couldn't catch you there.
I'd like to say one more thing about the Southern Baptist. He said he was one. Southern Baptist Convention was formed to support slavery. They've consistently supported Jim Crow laws, segregation, fought against women's equality and their right to vote. They've supported desegregation and were against civil rights. And Southern Baptists have the highest divorce rate in America because they suppress their women. And also, in the South, where there's the most fundamentalist Christians, we have the highest teen STD rates, highest teen pregnancy rates, highest obesity and heart disease, highest illiteracy, and lowest funding in performing schools, and the highest abortion rates in America compared to other developed nations.
Nick, would you like to ask Abel a question? Nick, we have a caller. Yeah, go ahead. Mute your TV, Nick, and you can go ahead with your question.
I can't hear anything.
All right, we've had a little caller trouble here. But, you know, I guess we could ask you one more question before we go to break and then bring you Moses on. If you had to go back on that day where you got arrested, would you have done anything differently?
No way.
No?
I mean, I don't feel bad for it. I think Christian fundamentalists need to be confronted, and it's not funny, and we shouldn't ignore them. They're very dangerous in their support of corrupt politicians.
Do you in any way think Moses is funny?
No, not at all.
No. Okay, we're going to try one more time for a caller. Brian, would you like to ask a question?
Yeah, I had a comment. Just listening to Abel and reading his columns for the past years, seems like Abel and Moses are like the same type of person, but on different ends of the spectrum, and hypocrisy being one of them. When I hear Abel mention about peace and love and kind of the hippie lifestyle or ways of thinking, and then he spits condemnation on Christians, it seems to me that he hates Christians.
No.
How do you justify that hypocrisy?
There's a lot of different types of Christians, and I mainly have a problem with fundamentalist Christianity. There's many Christians that do follow the teachings of Jesus more closely, not the Southern Baptists and not the fundamentalist Christians who take the Bible literally. I definitely don't have a problem with all Christians, and I appreciate Jesus' philosophy. And yes, I'm not perfect, and I do, I did have an anger problem when I was getting arrested, and that's keeping, I definitely don't have a problem with all Christians.
Well, we appreciate you coming on here and with this interview and taking some calls. We're actually going to go to break right now. We'll be back with both Moses and Abel, and they will debate on this Campus Crossfire special, Moses versus Abel, a debate of biblical proportion.
Get loose!
joining us for Arkansas on Campus.
In fact, thanks 1,046,000,000, the final tally for the campaign for the 21st century. The campaign provided 132 new endowed faculty positions, 1,738 new scholarships and fellowships. The overall endowment has grown to more than $650 million today. 13 buildings were completed or are in progress. Our benefactors have transformed the University of Arkansas now and for generations to come.
Open for three, good! Scotty!
Jones now throwing to the end zone, and it is complete! A touchdown!
Big swing and a fly ball to left field, hit pretty well. Going back is Napolitan, that ball's gone! That's a grand slam home run! Brady Toots just hit a grand slam home run, and the Razorbacks have taken the lead!
Solar Boat is one of our best examples of introducing students to multidisciplinary activity and what it means to play on a multidisciplinary team. We want them to be innovative. We want them to be creative. We want them to have solid communication skills. And what is best about it is the actual culminating event, which is a race.
You've got to be able to go fast for 300 meters. Then you also have to be able to go as far as you can in 4 hours with the same basic boat.
We have one driver and a bunch of engineers as a pit crew, and when things go wrong, they have to pull together, put their heads together, solve the problem in a very short amount of time, and get that boat back out on the water racing again.
We won the competition once. We finished second the last 2 years. In 2006 and in 2007, the competition is going to be in Fayetteville.
Welcome back to Campus Crossfire special, Moses versus Abel, a debate of biblical proportion. I'm joined now by both Gary and Adam. We're going to present more of a discussion than a debate between these two gentlemen. The phones are now closed. We appreciate your call-ins earlier. And again, we do advise you that this program may contain strong language and offensive material. Viewer discretion is advised. We're now going to show you a few clips of what actually happened on that day last fall that brought us to the position we're in, to where we can have this debate. This footage was shot by Adam Roberts, someone that you might have seen on UATV before. But we have a shot right here, and watch closely. It's really interesting.
Policy at the U of A says that Christian groups, they're okay, but there's a compromise they have to make to the homosexual. They have to say, you are welcome here. Have a seat. You can lead our prayers and vote with us and even preach. You can be our president. I know it makes no sense, but when we signed that purple form, that's what we meant. We don't discriminate. You can participate, especially when it comes to the offering plate.
After a few minutes, Abel appears from the library with a megaphone and his materials.
Yeah, like that.
It's a policy.
Abel shouts through the megaphone for nearly 7 minutes until UAPD arrives and takes Tomlinson into custody. You'll see that here coming up. What we've got, it seems like Abel had a phone call placed on behalf of Moses to have him removed. And that shot of him actually getting taken away is coming in just a second. A few moments here, we'll see Abel take out his aggression on the trash can in the Union line. So obviously a very heated exchange that afternoon, and now we have a few questions to present these gentlemen. Moses, we saw you reaching for your phone in the interview. Who were you calling, and did you call the police rather than trying to listen to him?
Well, today is a sad day, and I really had hoped that we could have a kind of exchange on here, that we kind of show ideas exchange, and that's what we like on the University Mall. But if you have somebody interrupting you and presenting ideas at a rapid fire pace that are full, chock full of misrepresentations or lies, it's really hard to have a good dialogue. So what I would hoped would have happened is I could get the police officers to help monitor the situation so that there would be an exchange of ideas that we could learn by, you know, instead of just interrupting and accusing. And I think I was accused of like not caring for children. And when I saw the false, you know, accusations, and if anybody loves humanity or is a pantheist or anything, they ought to at least not want to accuse. So it's the development of ideas. It's this idea of can someone wait their turn to talk? So I thought the police could help in that regard, and obviously he probably acted toward the police officer like he's acting toward me, and probably deserved to be arrested.
So you're still not
answering my question. That's a bunch of BS. That's a bunch of BS because I tried to debate him and tried to point out his hypocrisy and his danger, and he interrupted me, wouldn't let me speak to the students. That forced me to get the megaphone.
So, Abel, you spoke about the issue of morality. What exactly were you referring to? Who's right when it comes to morals?
I think morality is simple. It's just right versus wrong, and I think that he's missing. The Christians confuse morality and create this fake political morality, and it's not real. It's fake. It's not immoral to have long hair if you're a man or short hair. That's ridiculous and petty. And if there is a God, it's not that petty and doesn't have time to worry about stupid little. I mean, it's insignificant.
Would you like to respond, Moses?
Well, if I could, I mean, it's just kind of hard to respond in the midst of the rhetoric being shifted so fast.
Oh, come on.
You know, to have just a little bit of dialogue is important. But I'd just like to say this. I mean, and the whole thing is any time I'm preaching at the University of Arkansas, I always welcome comments.
You interrupted me, man, just like I'm interrupting you.
Please let me finish. The idea is I welcome dialogue, but I think at least it should always be, and this is what I try to do at the campus, a one-minute exchange, where somebody speaks for a minute without interruption, somebody else speaks for a minute without interruption, and let the ideas surface. And when we got that kind of respect, it usually works well.
But that's a lie. He doesn't do that. He interrupted me when I was trying to point out his pro-life hypocrisy and support for Bush.
Listen, you guys are just arguing about interrupting each other.
Let's
become a little more mature. We'll get back to the original question that I tried to ask you, Moses. Did you actually call the police that day to have Mr. Tomlinson escorted out?
Absolutely not.
You did not. So who do you believe had him taken away that day?
I believe he did it to himself by his conduct and his attitude.
I didn't do anything wrong except for have a megaphone without a permit. That's an infraction, not a misdemeanor.
So when would you say, what did you do with your phone then when you pulled it out, as we saw in the video there?
Well, basically, it's the same kind of thing we're dealing with now. I mean, just being the interruptions and the flow is a part of it. All we're asking for when we come to the University of Arkansas is to have a decent teaching setting so we can talk about the things of God without somebody else coming and talking over the message, interrupting the message, and then not playing by the rules. You've got to play by the rules in this life because God is in control. And if you don't play by the rules, you're going to face some consequences.
Now, please, answer my question. What did you do with your phone?
I mentioned this already. We asked for police to monitor the situation.
He called the cops.
Okay.
To monitor the situation.
Oh, no, we're gonna move on now. We've got some interesting questions that you all have provided for us. Apparently, Abel, you have a major problem with religious fundamentalism and its mm-hmm. support of Bush. Would you like to elaborate on that?
Well, I think that Bush and these fundamentalist Christians practice the opposite of the love of Christ, and so you could consider them antichrist. They practice greed and support greed for the wealthy with the tax cuts for the wealthy. Corporate war is the most privatized war in history. War profiteering, environmental deregulation. Dishonesty in leading us to war. They lied to put us in this war and in their claims of holiness. Hate towards homosexuals, Arabs, Katrina victims, and immigrants. Fear to win elections and to keep everyone stupid. Violence through torture and immoral and illegal war. Corruption with crooked lobbyists and stolen elections. Injustice and subversion of our democracy. Hold on. And why shouldn't we believe in real, actual morality like generosity, honesty, peace, love, and justice?
Now, Moses, would you like to respond to that?
Yes, I would. I would like to narrowly respond on the word honesty. If a man's preaching honesty and then he comes out and says, I don't care about children. Now, either he has a supernatural knowledge that I don't care about children or else that he's just a liar. Now, first of all, I care about children. One of the first things that happened on that day was Abel Tomlinson, in the name of honesty, started lying about Republicans don't care about children.
It's a fact.
And so the whole issue of caring about children, what kind of accusation is that? So one of the things we teach is if you're going to make a claim, have evidence to
back the claim.
I've
got it right here, buddy. I got it.
So I think that's kind of where we come to. The basic thing is honesty. And the reason I was speaking of him as a liar, this whole issue, some of the rules you got to go by in life is don't falsely accuse.
I'm not. I've got evidence right here, buddy. There's been...
You've both had a chance to respond. Now I'm going to ask Moses a question that he has been able to provide for us.
I didn't get to respond to him.
You talked to... about putting the fun back in fundamentalism. I don't exactly understand what you mean by that. Maybe you can elaborate.
That's
for
a stupid,
audience.
That's a ridiculous topic, and I didn't even get to respond to him. No, I want to respond.
Abel, a few seconds.
But this topic you're asking is ridiculous, and it's a diversion from the real substance.
Okay.
Now,
Moses, we'll get back to your question now.
Okay. Fundamentalism. I believe Jesus was filled with joy. And I believe Christianity is an awesome thing. And I think that sovereignty is awesome. And what I'm dealing with on the fun of fundamentalism is I love the Bible. I love every part of the Bible. And I love it when people claim they're honest and then they say the Bible says to dash children against the stone.
It says that.
And it doesn't.
Yes, it does.
I'm in a kind of a put up or shut up movement. If it says it, I will eat the Bible.
Okay.
If you can find where we're commanded to dash a child against the
God
stone.
God said to smash your
and
kids'
so,
heads against the stone.
Please let me finish, Abel. There's some rules. I think some rules of etiquette and civility here. But my thinking is when you get down to the whole issue of honesty, you need somebody, and all you out there who are supportive of the religion of Abel Tomlinson or any of his views, get somebody who tells the truth.
I've got to
that
tell
really
them
matters,
the truth,
you know?
Man. Psalms 137:9. God commands the infant should be dashed upon the rocks. It's right there, Psalms 137:9.
Doesn't say that.
Well, you know.
Anybody can open their Bible.
You know, we'll leave this to a different day, possibly another Crossfire special. And Moses eats the Bible.
If it says it, I'll eat the Bible.
It's one of those things where I don't think we're going to come to a commonplace agreement on.
Can I jump in a minute?
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
It should be, we're smart enough to know that we can read a verse and see if it says to dash children against the stone
it
or not.
It says that.
Because it's not like a room for interpreting it.
Okay, Abel, we'll get to one of your questions again. You apparently have a problem with the Bible and the belief system, and more of its interpretation. Can you civilly argue this, or am I just going to have to cut you off every time?
Just cut me off, dude. I don't give a shit, dude.
This is not acceptable.
Well, I don't care. You guys aren't acceptable. He's saying that I don't have evidence, and you wouldn't even let me provide the evidence.
I apologize. You did provide the evidence, however.
Not for the first point.
It is our audience that is here to decide. You can't win a point with us sitting here because it's the audience that's all watching. You know, if you're out there making a civil point, they're going to agree with you. You're not going to know about it right now.
But moving on,
would you like to talk about the interpretation of the Bible and the belief system?
Yeah, I think that if you interpret it literally, it's very scary. It shows that God is not pro-life. He murders millions of people and supports the murdering of millions of people. He says to kill all these people, witches, homos. So he should be supporting the killing of all these people.
So how would you say that you're a Christian if you...
I'm not a Christian.
So what are you? You talk about you're not an atheist, but you are
a pantheist.
A pantheist. What does that mean?
It says that God is everything and everything is God, which is supported by the laws of physics and evolution.
And we've talked about Moses being a non-denominational. However, many things have been out there about you being a Southern Baptist. Or
he said that today. He's a Southern Baptist.
And it's true. We did read that in the North.
I'm a member of the Southern Baptist Church. I'm happy to say so.
Okay. Well, that's very good. We'd like to talk about possibly the end times now, and you both have very strong feelings on this, I understand. So let's try to keep it civil between us, and maybe we can have a real discussion on how you feel the world is going to come to an end, or is it? We'll start with you, Moses.
Well, I have to divert just a little bit back to, and this is why when the University of Arkansas said you can have 5 days, limited me to 5 days to speak my message, obviously, this quick microwave jolt around with religion and ideas is not going to go right with the minds of people that need to learn. But I'm just reading the Bible right here. Psalm 137:9. Happy shall he be that taketh and dasheth thy little ones against the stones. It's a prophecy that God has said there's going to be some people happy for bringing judgment upon people. This is a prophecy that there's going to be some sick minds that are happy for doing sick activity. This is in no way a commandment to kill a child. So just another proof and point. I think you just got to take a little time there. But when it comes right down to the whole message of what you're asking and what you're having us do, the end times, there is going to be a day where Jesus Christ is coming back to judge the world. And I'm so glad, because liars at that time will have their part in the lake which burneth with fire.
This is what's so scary, is that there's 50 million of these evangelicals. Half the evangelicals are good and support environmental protections. But the other 50 million, such as him, fundamentalist Christians, they think that Armageddon's coming, end times is coming, and they welcome it. They want Jesus to come back and rapture them to heaven so everybody else can burn in hell. The scary part is they think the planet's future is irrelevant because it has no future. They think Satan's in charge, including the UN. We're in the end times, and Christ is coming. They welcome war and environmental destruction. They welcome global warming because that means that Christ is coming. So nuclear bombs would be good in their view.
So how do you respond, Moses, about are fundamentalists, those that do not support the environment or pro-war, are you any of those things?
Well, I think that safety is a big issue. And I think that, you know, the issue of coming right down to it, and I'm sorry that we're having to deal with just accusations that aren't founded.
Yes, they
are. But when you get down to the issue of that we're for nuclear war, I mean, that's just pretty absurd.
Well, you want the end times to come, don't you?
But when it comes right down to the bottom line of it all, we love our environment. We want to have safe water. We want to have safe, air, all the stuff, clean air, the whole thing.
Why does that matter if Christ is coming and the world's going to be destroyed?
Please let me finish. It's important to me. So the whole idea comes back to just, can we love people enough to just, you know, stand by the truth of the Bible? Because without Scripture, without the Bible, really there is no real standing, lasting truth left in this world. If the Bible's wrong, there's no hope for this world. If Jesus is not coming, we are messed up.
There are leading evangelical televangelists that believe the same thing as him, that do in fact literally state that they welcome environmental destruction and war. They're for stronger nuclear armaments.
But that person, in
scary,
this instance, is not Moses, and we must respect that.
They're in the same group.
We talk about diversity on this campus, and you know, if you were watching the video right when you came on, there was a song that that Moses had decided to sing on diversity. Do you have a strong opinion on? It seems to me like I heard homosexuals being a main focus of that song. What are you trying to get across with, you know, you told us earlier you like to sing in your songs?
Yeah, that song is particularly special to me because it addresses the issue of the affirmative action policy at the University of Arkansas, which requires Christian groups to have non-Christian leaders in their group to be registered at the university. And I can't register a student group at a university because we won't sign the form that says we will promote equal opportunity through affirmative action to have leaders who are not Christian in our Christian organization, whether they're homosexual or whether they're another religion or atheist. Whatever their, you know, sexual orientation, marital status, or religion is, you have to equally welcome them as leaders in your group. And any registered Bible group on this campus is either lying or they're promoting homosexual leaders in their group, and that's just the bottom line.
Do you know a few of those groups off the top of your head?
Yeah, the Catholic group, the Assemblies of God group, the Baptist groups, Methodist groups here on the university, all the registered groups are signing a form to promote non-Christian leaders in the Christian group. The Muslims are signing the same form that they'll have Christian leaders of their Muslim group, and if they don't, they can't be registered here at the university, even though that's illegal against the Constitution.
Tolerance and love, what a problem. I think it's funny that he's so hateful towards homosexuals, and it says to kill homosexuals in the Bible, so I don't know why he's not killing them and killing me because I'm a heretic to him. But also, it's funny that he only thinks the King James is the only right version when King James was definitely a homosexual who had sex with young men. He had sex with the Duke of Lennox, the Earl of Somerset, and the Duke of Buckingham. Why do you keep going like this? Look it up, man.
So we're back to the issue.
Back here to some accusations. I mean, really, that you prove that King James is a homosexual.
It's history,
man. I will eat the King James Bible.
It's history. Sorry.
So when you come to campus, Moses, do you feel that you're safe? Is that an issue for you at all? Is that something that you have to feel concerned about when you come here? Is it something that do you feel like at any time you may be?
Yeah, there's a problem here. There's a problem at the University of Anarchy, and here's the problem. At U of A, we have an issue with sometimes students don't respect space zones, safety space, and perhaps you get close enough to somebody in a violent rage, they're liable to go throwing fists, and it's really hard to monitor. So there's been some problem with just keeping safety. But on the spiritual side of it, and the part that scares Mr. Thomas and others, is I really feel like that there is a judgment of the Lord, a cup of God's wrath that can come upon a campus that so mocks God with the fraternities, sororities, and the sin that's going on the campus. That's, to me, a bigger issue. But yet, with the safety, I do think that we need to try to do something to, I got a question. Can I ask you a question? Is the university outdoors, is it more like a public park, or is it more like a military base? And when society answers that question, we'll know what kind of restraints we should have on speech outside, whether it's Abel Tomlinson or whether it's me preaching. I don't think the outdoors of the university is like a military base. I think it's like a public park, and freedom of speech should go on out there just like it would on a street corner or a public park. And if somebody's right up nose to nose to you on a street corner, you have a right to call the police to get some distance between you. If you're on a military base, they may not even let you have a conversation outdoors. But I don't think we're in a military setting, and I think this is a big deal. In fact, what Abel's went through, this is an awesome deal, because we are right now, this is a big thing. The Supreme Court's not taking the cases yet. There's not case law establishing it yet, but what is a college campus? Is it a free speech zone, or is it absolutely something that they can shut us down for talking without a permit? You have to get a permit to talk outdoors at the U of A.
Yeah,
it's
Abel,
amazing.
Would you like to respond to that? Do you feel unsafe at this campus, and do you believe that you should be able to come and...
I've had experience just getting arrested. I feel my free speech was violated, and also I think that I've tried to write. I write a lot of things to the Traveler, and a lot of sometimes they get rejected. In the past, I've had some trouble getting them published. So I feel that free speech is somewhat limited, but I don't think that's a major issue. What I have more of a problem with him than the university and the policemen that arrested me.
Do you feel that you yourself are a radical in your beliefs?
No, not at all. I think I'm very rational, and I base most of my beliefs on science and philosophy that makes sense.
So we've had a fairly interesting discussion. For the time period, I'm going to give you guys about 30, 40 seconds to just close up and give your final message on what would you like for viewers to take away from this this debate here.
Well, I would like to just take the 30 seconds to say this. I love preaching at the U of A. I hope that students will come out when we're out on the Union Mall or at the Peace Fountain or wherever we gather and come and learn and teach me. And I want to be judged. I want to be criticized. If there's truth that I'm failing in some area, and obviously I am because I'm a fallible human being, I want to be corrected and taught the right direction. So I welcome, whether it's Abel Tomlinson or whether it's other students, just to have a fair and friendly and focused dialogue on the campus, because God loves the University of Arkansas.
Abel?
I'd just like to say that these pro-lifers like him and Bush are hypocrites. You know, once you're born, you're off their loveless. It's more like they're pro-embryo. They're pro-torture and pro-war. This war costs $2.3 trillion. Tax cuts cost $1 trillion. 1 million children die a month. Most could be prevented for less than a dollar a day. This money, these trillions of dollars, could save all those children. And it could also, you know, educate the whole planet. And so they're not really pro-life. During the Bush administration, they've cut billions in programs to the poor, food, housing, health care, public education. So they're not really pro-life. It's a lie.
Well, we thank you guys for both coming to speak with us on this Moses versus Abel, the debate of biblical proportions.
Enjoyed it.
We thank you guys. We've had a great time. We want to thank our viewers for your great comments that you've been able to take with us. And we want to let you know that next week on this show, we're going to have comments from those of you that attended the U of A watch party at the Union. And that's pretty much all the time we have, I would say. For Moses and Abel, I'm Spencer Pyland. And as always, from the USA to the U of A, it's on Campus Crossfire.